You still have time to sign up for the Rosary Congress, an opportunity to pray the Holy Rosary as well as the Eucharistic Adoration. This starts on Monday with the 11 a.m. Mass in the chapel. There are open hours where you are needed. Sign up. She is in the vestibule. Please stop by to answer Jesus' invitation to pray 1 hour with him. The Apostle's Choir, Cantor Corps, and Bell of Palmasola have resumed weekly rehearsals. Choir and cantors meet in the church on Tuesday evenings. Bells of Palmasola Handbell Choir meets on Wednesday. New cantors are welcome by addition. Mark your calendar, the first ever Fall Craft and Vendor Fair Show, October 28th. One-of-a-kind craft and gifts and baked goodies and a classic car show to follow. For information on these and other upcoming parish activities, please take home a bulletin or visit our website. Out of respect for the Eucharist, please turn off all cell phones and electronic devices.
Hi, I'm Katie.
Hello, I'm Lily.
And we are going to the National Catholic Youth Conference in 47 days. We will be boarding a plane from Sarasota and will arrive in Indianapolis along with 25,000 other Catholic teens from across the United States. We are beyond excited.
Do you know our parish has sent over 172 teens to this conference since 1999? Why is this so important? It's important we get to see the big picture at a conference like this, so we get to see the young Catholic Church is alive and thriving.
The reason we have gotten to go over the past 24 years is because of the generosity of parish members like you. We are the future of the church. We want you to be proud of us.
We are here today to thank you. Our families have contributed to our church, and all those teal blue envelopes added up, and we are now ready to go.
By the way, if you could say a few extra prayers from us, November 16th to the 19th, we would greatly appreciate it. Not to mention, for Father Mark, Jean and Carlos Goofy, and Michaela Dorflinger, our youth minister, they are our brave chaperones.
Thank you again for your support and generosity. We will give you an update on our return.
Let us gather together singing the God of all grace. Please stand.
Oh. church and visiting friends. And we'd like to thank Katie and Lily for introducing themselves to you as part of the young people group, small group that we're taking in Indianapolis in a few weeks. I've never been referred to as a brave chaperone before, but I guess that's what I am. So I thank the other adults who are helping us in this, and it's always been a very moving and powerful experience for the young people of our parish. And I thank you for your faithful donations that have made this possible. Each of the young people going had to raise a certain amount of money, but without your help, it wouldn't have been possible. So I thank you for that. So as we gather today, we give thanks to God for all things, and we ask God to be present at the altar, present upon us to bless us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with
we join together to celebrate the sacred mysteries. We pause now and call to mind our sins. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Thank you.
parent does not dare to ask. We make this in all our prayers to our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for me.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let me now sing of my friend's song concerning his vineyard. My friend had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He spaded, cleared of stones, and planted the choicest vines. Within it, he built a watchtower and hewed out a winepress. Then he looked for the crops of grapes, but what it yielded was wild grapes. Now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I had not done? Why, when I looked for the crops of grapes, did it bring forth only wild grapes? Now I will let you know what I mean to do with my vineyard. Take away its hedge, give it to grazing, break through its wall, let it be trampled. Yes, I will make it a ruin. It shall not be pruned or hoed, but overgrown with thorns and briars. I will command the clouds not to send rain upon it. The vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his cherished plant. He looked for judgment, but see bloodshed. For justice, but hark the outcry. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, have no anxiety at all, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. Then the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and mind in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is gracious, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. And the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Praise to your God.
Again, we welcome you and thank you for being with us, parishioners, visiting friends. We continue in this section of Matthew's Gospel with what we can call parables. That's the way Matthew introduces this in the words of Jesus today. But as I was reading about this, it's really more of an allegory. It's really telling a story. It doesn't have so much a lesson to be learned, but a reality revealed. And in this, Jesus tells the story of a landowner who had a vineyard. Now, unlike some of the other stories that we've heard in recent weeks that were only contained in Matthew's gospel, this one happens to be in Matthew, in Mark, and in Luke. So in telling this story, the emphasis is clear. Jesus said there was a landowner. He had a vineyard. He prepared the whole thing. He planted the vineyard. He put a hedge around it to protect it. He dug out a wine press, and he put in a tower. The tower, in the other translations, says watchtower. And what it means in the presence of that is simply, that's where the ones who are attending to the vineyard would reside while they are caring for the vineyard, and it's elevated so they can see if there's any potential danger. So it's elevated and a place so that they are safe, but they also can see what is happening and live there for their term of renting this property or this vineyard. And then he tells this story in such a way that it gives us a moment to look back at the first reading from Isaiah, when Isaiah is talking about a poem about a vineyard. And in that, in the story that Isaiah tells, it mentions that he's going to destroy it. It's going to be done away with because it has not been used properly. And so it is today when Jesus tells this story. The scribes and the Pharisees, the elders of the people, were there. And the purpose of this is very clear to them. They cannot mistake this. And in this, the vineyard is Israel, where the people are residing. And the landowner is the image of God the Father. And he has leased it out to the tenants. And that is all of the people who are the tenants. And with that, then unfolds the complexity of what has happened and what they've rejected. And they saw all the way through as he told this story how much it represented them and how they were living or failing to live. And in this, when it came time for the harvest, he sends his, says slaves, he sends his workers out to get his share. And there are a couple of ways that that can happen. They can pay with the actual grapes from the vineyard. They can pay with actual money, or even by producing some of the wine that he's given. So there was options on how the owner could be paid. And he tells them that the servants were not received. It says, one they stoned, another they beat up, and a third they insulted. Well, I don't know which of that is worse. I guess if I had to pick one, I'd say I'd rather be insulted than stoned. But in any event, they didn't give him his due. And the parallel there is that God the Father sent the prophets, and they haven't listened to what the prophets said. Those are the first servants. And then he sent other servants, and as you can expect, they were treated in exactly the same way. And now comes the clincher. He said, I will send my son. Certainly they will hear him and respect him. And that's the reference to himself. God has sent him so that they would be inspired to do what was right and to live the life that God had provided for them in this vineyard. All they had to do was to care for it properly. It would produce. And in their greed and in their rejection of God, they said, this is the son, the heir. Let's kill him. All this will be ours. Now, interestingly, as you read the other two accounts, there's something that is not communicated there the same way as Matthew tells it today. They kill the son and drag him out of the vineyard. But Matthew said, they dragged him out of the vineyard and killed him. That is very important. Remember, Matthew writes to the Jewish community, and you did not shed blood on the lands you are to harvest. That's very important because then that land is cursed. To shed human blood in that was considered a terrible violation. So Matthew brings that into the story. They dragged the son out of the vineyard and killed him so that the vineyard would not be tainted. And then Jesus said to his listeners, what do you think the landowner will do? And they come with a very strong, he will bring those wretched men to a wretched end. Very powerful way to say that. And he will lend out his property to other people who will do what is right. They were being told that they were not living as God had intended them to live. It's a very dramatic and very drastic example. But they're supposed to realize that it's about them. Only earlier today, we received the news, if you had not heard, massive attacks in Israel. Over 300 people were killed. Hamas launched thousands of rockets into the known areas to kill the Jewish people. Thousands were injured, and it said over 300 were killed, and most likely it would be more. And it's 50 years to the day when this happened before. And yet, the gospel tells us that that has always happened. And Jesus was calling the people out for their hatred for others. And that it needed to change, to do what God, Yahweh, called them to do. I hope today in our prayers we can lift up those people that die. You know, these real militant groups that attack. And how dreadful it is to live under that type of fear. In the story, Jesus said, did you never read that the stone rejected by the builders becomes the cornerstone? And even if they rejected the son, that is still the cornerstone. That becomes the building block, in a more drastic way, of what God has in store for us. And God provides for all of us if we just respond to what God has given us. Today, in our own journey, it's easy to want to reject certain things about the faith, about society, about mores and guidance in our world. For somehow we always think we know better. And yet God has given us a great world and a great setting where if we respond appropriately, God rewards us by doing what is right and good. So today as we hear this story, not only applies to the people of ages past when Jesus spoke these words, but it continues even in the tragedy that happened today. The people are not responding in that distant but very holy and sacred area we call the Holy Lands, Israel. And daily for ourselves, gives us a moment of pause to reflect on how we are doing. Say, well, I didn't send any rockets or bombs over there. No, but how are we doing in our relationship with those around us? This story is intended to draw us closer to know that God abundantly gives. All we are asked to do is to respond appropriately. prayers today be for those who suffer, and pray that we can be guided to do what is right and good, to respond to God's invitation, to hear the Son, not to reject him, but to see that stone, Jesus Christ, that has become the cornerstone of our faith. May the Lord bless you. We stand now to offer our profession of faith and creed. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us sin and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified and conscious Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Our universal prayers. St. Paul instructs us present our needs to God in petitions full of gratitude.
For Pope Francis and all leaders of the Church, that they continue to challenge us to true conversion to God's will, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the world's citizens to grow in reverence for the sanctity of all human life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our civic leaders, they be good stewards to our obligations to care for the planet. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For refugees and immigrants, that they be welcomed as children of God and receive the protection and assistance they need. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our servicemen and women serving in all parts of the world, first responders, police, firefighters, and medical personnel, that they may enjoy God's protection. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who gather at this table of love, that they may see in one another's eyes the love of Jesus. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, hospitalized, and homebound of our community, and for all those written in our parish intention books, that their hearts be filled with peace and hope. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, especially Larry H. Smith, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In silent prayer, let us offer God the needs of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray also for that all troubled areas of the world, especially the conflict underway in Israel. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God who created heaven and earth, protect what you have planted. Guide your people who pray always in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
I invite you to be seated. I ask you to locate the basket in the front row of each section. If you can make your offering in stewardship and pass the basket to those behind you, and the ushers will receive those baskets at the back of each section.
Save your friend.
two people. Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the church.
Accept, O Lord, we pray, the sacrifices instituted by your commands, and through the sacred mysteries which we celebrate with dutiful service, graciously complete the sanctifying work by which you are pleased to redeem us. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you so loved the world that in your love, that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son. By his obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we have lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as an exaltation we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Glorious martyrs and all the saints of whose constant intercession we rely. God for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Frank, our Bishop, the order of bishops, with the clergy, the religious, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family you have summoned before you, and your compassionate, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you, at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever.
Thank you.
father and mother in me. Lord Jesus Christ, through the gospel mystery of your death and resurrection, may be present in every holy mass. Pour out your healing love on our church and on our world. Grant that as we lift you up during this time of Eucharistic revival, your Holy Spirit may draw all people to join us at the banquet of our life. You live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray. Grant us, Almighty God, that we may be refreshed and nourished by the sacrament which we have received, so as to be transformed into what we consume. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God